Good morning and welcome to worship here at Second-Ponce de Leon Baptist Church. As always, we are grateful you have taken this time to be with us and to join us for worship. We are especially grateful to those of you who are first-time guests, those of you who are returning guests, and those of you who are regular returners. We are glad that you are here in this space to experience what God has to offer us this morning. We would ask those of you who are guests if you would just do one thing for us and one thing only. There are visitors' cards in the pew rack before you, and you may have to ask somebody to reach and grab one for you, but if you would mind just telling us a little bit about who you are so we can know something about you and get to know each other in that way, that would do us a big favor, and you can place that in the offering plate later as that comes by. But to all of you, again, welcome, and there are things to know about in the life of our church, as always, and so let me share some of those with you. In the back of your order of service, your bulletin, there are a list of announcements and especially things this week that you'll want to know about. And so I will share some of those with you, some of these things you can read through and learn more about here and also on our website and other places. But to know about coming up quickly this week, you may have noticed, as I said last week as well, on your way in, there are two collection bins in the North Bridge lobby. One is for our Buckhead Christian Ministry food drive happening this month in July. We'll be collecting food this month, and then August 1st, going to visit Buckhead Christian Ministry to do some service work there and deliver the food we're gathering. But ending this week is our Edgewood Church school supplies drive for our friends and neighbors down in Edgewood area of Atlanta. You'll notice Wednesday is the last day to bring in some of those school supplies, and if you're curious of what to bring, you can go by the Northbridge area. There's a little flyer that tells you exactly what they're especially needy for this year to help our children get to school with the right supplies and equipment. So that ends this Wednesday. Also coming up this week, the deadline to sign up for the adult visit to the Dillard House in Jaymore Farms. If you're curious, there's more information here in your order of worship, but Friday is the deadline for that, so please take note. And then coming up a week from today, our kids are gathering together. I'll make sure I get this right, Peachtree Hills Park. Is that right? Peachtree Hills Park. The children's ministry kickball game and picnic. So next Sunday, July 26th, 5 p.m., gather together, have a good time, play some kickball, but also remember to wear shoes. You will be kicking things at that event. So flip-flops don't work as well. Wear some shoes. Peachtree Hills Park, 5 o'clock next week. And then you'll see some other announcements about our Wednesday night programming coming up the rest of the summer and this fall. You'll want to take note of our quarterly church conference this Wednesday. But as always, there's many things happening in the life of our family. And if you're curious to know more, ask one another, ask one of us, find out ways to find more and to get plugged in. But like I said, we are glad you're here. We are anticipating a beautiful day of worship. Again, our choir is on leave this week after their good work, and we're grateful for those who are leading us in worship this morning. Let us turn to a time of worship and to a time of prayer together now. Almighty God, you have promised to be with us and long ago sent your Spirit to abide among us and to guide us to a future of goodness and hope. We come now seeking your truth, your justice, your kindness. And God, you are with us this morning. Let us feel your presence and welcome you into our lives. Come and fill these desires of our hearts. Give to us, your church, O God, the power to comprehend the height and depth of the love of Christ, that your power at work within us may accomplish abundantly far more than we can ask or imagine. May we know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that we may be filled with the fullness of God. And now, as we have gathered together to worship you, open our eyes to your presence among us. Open our hearts and minds to hear your voice, to recognize your call, and to faithfully follow where you lead. Fill us with the abundance of your Spirit, that we may be fruitful disciples of the one whose compassion reaches across all boundaries, our Savior Jesus Christ, in whom we pray. Amen.
sisters, will you join and help us? Moses' sister aided him. Will you help the trembling mourners who are struggling hard with sin? Tell them all about the Savior. Tell them that he will be found. Sisters, pray and holy.
Thankful for Steve Rotz, who is leading our singing this morning, because you may have noticed that Eric Nelson is at the organ this morning. I think we have a pretty good backup organist, don't you? We're glad Verlene is away and enjoying a rest. Doc is also away. I hope you caught the line in the hymn we just sang about trying to preach. I'll be the one trying to preach this morning in Doc's absence, and you are a worthy gift on our return from having been out of town. Elizabeth and I are genuinely glad to see you as a church family this morning. Let's join our voices together in a responsive reading of the 145th Psalm. If you will take up when the bold print gets here, we'll read those lines together. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate. The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed, and I will declare your greatness. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your faithful shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power to make known to all people your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, satisfying the desire of every living thing. The Lord is just in all his ways and kind in all his doings. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desire of all who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless his holy name forever and ever.
His glory fills. This morning's gospel reading is from John chapter 14, verses 15 through 24, and can be found on page 877 of your pew Bible. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will reveal yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him, Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me.
Now a reading from the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 28 through 31, page 580 in your pew Bibles. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
In the palm. not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you
scripture reading from Ephesians chapter 3 is the scripture that our sermon will be based upon. We'll be reading verses 14 through 21, and that's found on page 950 in the New Testament section of your pew Bible. For this reason, Paul says, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Join me as we pray. God of this good word, word which has carried prayer within it, we thank you for friends over the centuries who have taken care of the church. She has been entrusted to us now, and we join with worshipers the world over this day for the words that form our faith, for the spirit that steadies our hearts. We give you thanks. All too slowly we learn over a lifetime that it is relationships that are at the heart of that church, and relationships that are the most precious gifts we carry with us in life. May we care about the things that you care about with a growing dedication. This morning we gather having been shocked once again by violence nearby. We are saddened and perplexed by the human capacity to do harm, such as what we saw in Chattanooga. Our prayers for them fall upon your gracious ears. Attend to their deepest needs even more than you do our most pressing questions. We lift our concerns to you. We lift our loved ones to you on this day. We pray for those we love. We lift our own cares. Tend to our hearts. And we pray that you would find fertile gardens in which to grow love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
It is good to be back here among you on this Sunday. Doc and I acknowledged a few weeks ago that we would basically wave at each other as we came back into town, and Doc and Melissa went out of town, and we pray for them while they're gone. Speaking of, we got some challenging news, as you are aware, and it was good to know that you were here praying for us and Elizabeth's family, and so we thank you for that, and you've made that evident as we've walked the halls today, and we thank you for the strength that you lend us, and that we can count on you all as church family. We've been keeping you in our hearts this week as well, and some of you very specifically in our hearts as some of you face challenges during this week back here at home. We're glad to be back with you, and it is a privilege to be here in front of you. Let me ask you a question, though, as we start. Are you competitive? We all know that friend or family member who we love very much, but drives us a little batty because their story has to always be one notch above ours, or if we buy a new car, they buy the same one, but they've got to have the gold edition. If we tell a joke, theirs is funnier. If you walk 3 miles, they jog six. You got a master's degree? They got two. I confess, I am competitive. Mostly with myself these days. I'm also competing with a very warm room, and I acknowledge that this morning. You will not offend me by your fanning. Do whatever you have to stay with me. But mostly nowadays, competition happens within my hobbies or the little things in every day. Elizabeth will tell you that just simply wadding up a piece of paper to throw it in the trash can devolve into a one-man pickup game where each shot has to come from a little farther out. And why celebrate my last writing project when the next one is waiting to be found? I have to compete with myself because I guess I enjoy having something. It's got a little edge to it, a little energy to it. As a group of us planned our 30th high school reunion, we met several times a few years ago. That reunion has come and gone, but an old friend asked me, he said, that time, I think I've told you about this, that time you hit me in the neck with a fastball, I gotta ask you, was that on purpose? Trusting the grace of 35 years past, because we'd faced him back when I was in elementary school still. 35 years later, I trusted that the real answer was okay, and I said, yeah, I did. I mean to hit you in the neck, but I hit you on purpose. And he said, why? And I said, because you always dug in a little too close at the plate, and I got tired of it. And he accepted that answer, and it made sense to him. Paul was writing to the church in Ephesus, and actually here in the middle of it, right here in the middle of his letter to the church, he started praying for them. He knew that no matter how much he wrote, how much guidance he sent, how many times he preached and they heard or heard about it, he couldn't give them all that they needed. The Ephesians were facing some daunting challenges, and part of what made their own lives as a church or a family of faith so challenging is that what they brought to the table really wasn't helping a whole lot. Being the church wasn't a self-help project, commentary writer Edwin Searcy says about this letter to the Ephesians. Being church wasn't a self-help project. So Paul was turning them over to God as the ultimate source for the days ahead. Being a stronger spouse, being a better friend, a healthier sibling, isn't a self-help project either, is it? Another writer, George Stroop, says that the Christian tradition has long known that how one lives in relation to God is a pretty clear window to how we live with others. Can you live healthfully in competition with those you love the most? I have received a fair amount of attention locally for my divorce recovery work because it's unique, and also for my premarital counseling work with couples because that's all too unique. What no one is supposed to know about is how many veteran couples over the years have also taken me up on the offer to spend 5 weeks in private marriage tune-up work. Now, if I just described you, don't worry. There are no names or specific stories. But over the years, a lot of couples have seen that announcement and taken me up on that and come and spent 5 weeks. We start them off with an analysis instrument that gives a snapshot of their relationship, and it's a picture that takes into account what they are now, some 5, 10, or sometimes as much as 25 years later, and then we get to work. And I didn't go into that work looking for any one factor to rise up above all others. I know as well as any that marriage can't be boiled down to any one moving part. There are aspects you can work on, and then there are aspects that are just full of chemistry and mystery. The same is true for a good friendship or a healthy work relationship, any family setting. But over the years, I couldn't deny noticing that so many of the lovers who have gone to the altar at one point had somehow transformed into competitors over the years. Couple after couple would come to me, and many of them would come in on the first day and blurt out the issue that they felt like they needed to work on, and we would. But more often than I could believe, I began to notice, it became obvious that what lay at the root of their pain much of the time, their chosen issue, was that they felt that they had become rivals now. And today we as a culture have homes being run by competitors, living under the same roof, trying to parent, trying to love, trying to run the small company that they unwittingly created that day they went to the altar and got married. But secretly, they've given in to scorekeeping. They've done damage to one another or hurt each other with words. Some began to lie to each other. Eventually, some found another to love. Far more of them simply just felt like giving up and checking out. It's not a whole lot different from the dynamic Paul was discovering in some of the early churches like Ephesus. Funny how a lot of the same things that work well at church also work well at home. And the things that do damage at church or at work also do damage at home. Commentary writer and professor, friend of our congregation, because he just taught here a few weeks ago, Thomas Slater, says this about the Ephesians in his commentary. Many people, he says, say that competition brings advancement. Rarely do people who love others and wish the best for others say this, though. The statement gives some people the license to ignore the feelings and the talents of others and just do what they want. That was his assessment of what was going on at Ephesus, as Paul wrote. So let me ask you, do you believe the fad little statement that's been with us as a culture for decades? I've mentioned it to you before. True love means never having to say you're sorry. Sounded nice in a movie. Looks nice on a bumper sticker. People who do this, though, I've noticed rarely ever say anything loving, do they? Or as one Christian comedian said, I've learned, he says, when someone tells you they want to say something to you in love, you should duck first. And then reply, go ahead and say what you were going to say, and I'll let you know later if it was loving. There's a movie that I don't think of as being all that old, but I've noticed it started playing on the classic channels now. Billy Crystal, Jack Palance, and a host of others starred in City Slickers. A bunch of restless guys from white-collar jobs in urban settings decide they need a man's trip. They aren't happy at work, they aren't happy at home, so they chose a dude ranch out west, even though none of them came from a background like that. And in these movies, the gruff old trailhand Curly took them in and tried to show them how to ride horses and live on the trail. And time after time, he keeps telling them that there is a need to discover life's one thing. And he'd hold up a gloved hand and a finger pointing in the air. And they finally, later in the movie, begged Curly, please tell us what that one thing is. And so they're riding along, and later Curly asks the guys, do you know what the secret of life is yet? Have you found it? And he holds up one finger again. This, he says. And Billy Crystal's character, Mitch, says, one finger? Curly says, one thing. Just one thing, you stick to that, and the rest don't mean anything. But what is the one thing, they asked? And Curly smiles and says, "Ah, that you have to find for yourself." Well, keep in mind that I told you that I couldn't possibly boil a healthy marriage or a mature friendship or a healthy church or a successful way to relate to your parents or your siblings down to just one thing. There's no way we'll ever be able to boil everything down to one relational factor. But if you forced me to point out a single relational principle that drives, I think, so many of the other moving parts, some of these married couples have convinced me. In healthy, fair, and equal relationships, we have to want good outcomes for the other person just as much as we want them for ourselves. And I think Paul is getting at that for the church and for other relationships that matter in our lives, just as Christ before him said the same thing, love others as you love yourself. I've become convinced that this one thing for relationships could be that when you genuinely want as much good for your spouse as you want for yourself, you'll do things in that relationship differently. When you want as much good for the person you share any relationship that matters with, a friendship, a cubicle at work, committee at the church, when you want as much for them as you do for yourself, you'll share your resources differently. It'll pain you to lie to them. You make decisions with them in mind just as much as you are yourself. You don't push them around and you don't make selfish decisions nearly as often. And if you're at work and care about the company or your boss or the community like this, you'll do an honest day's work. You'll do good work. At home, lovers haven't lost these capacities, but competitors wonder if they'll ever regain the magic again. Problem is, I realize all this is tricky. Left to ourselves, the list of people about whom we probably feel this way is painfully short. This is a high standard to aim for. And that's why the good news of our text is we're not left to ourselves. The writer Anne Lamott tells of her profound experience of Christ indwelling in her. She tells the story a little colorfully, but she was essentially unmarried and pregnant and decided to have an abortion. She coped with the emotional pain in her usual way by indulging in substances. And one night when she couldn't rest, it was a night where she became aware of someone in the room with her. She writes, "The feeling was so strong that I actually turned on the light to make sure that no one was there, and of course there wasn't. But after a while in the dark again, I knew beyond any doubt that it was Jesus." What she felt was appalled. No one in her immediate life was a Christian, it seemed. They were all like the Ephesians, sophisticated and in need of no one but themselves. She began going to a funky little church on Sundays occasionally. And the next Sunday after this encounter, she went back yet again, and she could not escape the feelings. It was as if the people around her were singing in between the notes, she says, weeping and joyful at the same time. And she says, "I felt like their voices or something was rocking me in its bosom, holding me like a scared kid. And I opened up to that feeling, and it washed over me." And when she got back to her houseboat, she opened the door and hung her head and said aloud to the only person there beside herself, "Jesus, I give, I quit. You can come in." And in the fellowship and company of that church, Lamott had found a microcosm of the larger picture of our faith, of what our faith proclaims. She had found people who care about others around them as much as they cared for themselves. people who ultimately helped to usher her into the fellowship with Jesus Christ. And when God helps us to discover that one thing, our lives become better. Our marriages have a fighting chance to become healthy. Our friendships become more genuine. Our family lives have one more person giving the system a chance to be better. Our churches have one more person who can model the kingdom of God instead of hate or dysfunction. At the beach this past week, Elizabeth almost stepped on something tiny. She picked it up and upon looking at it realized it was one piece from the board game Battleship. So we began looking through the cabinet. She wanted to return the piece to its box. And she pulled it out. There it was, Battleship. And I said to her, "I've never played Battleship." Well, at my age, she looked at me like I was from Pluto. And she kept the box out. And we agreed that we were gonna play Battleship. And we did. She took the directions out, reacquainted herself with the game. We got all set up. She explained to me what little I needed to know to begin to play. And we started taking turns, calling out numbers, letters and numbers. And I began to get into it like I always do. And eventually, I called out a letter and a number combination. And she said, "You sunk my cruiser." And I smiled. And eventually she sunk one or two of mine, and I sunk her submarine, and eventually we hit each other's cruisers, and the game was on. I won one, we played a second one. She ended up winning that one, but what I began to pick up on was something I hadn't expected, because I grew up with a lot of guys when we were playing things like that, and Elizabeth would hit one of mine, and I'd say, "You sunk my battleship," and she said, "I'm sorry." And I thought to myself, there's no sorry in Battleship. The longer we played, she would apologize when she sunk one of my ships. And eventually I heard myself say, "I'm sorry," when she told me I'd just sunk one of hers. And it totally reminded me that there was a bigger picture to what we were doing. And that at the root of it, it was two human beings enjoying each other's company in a really relaxed setting. Our scripture today picked up right in the middle of a thought. I hope verbally you heard that, and it may have puzzled you. Verse 14 started off like this: "For this reason," now we should wonder what the reason was, and you'll have to look back in order to discover that. "For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. And I pray that according to the riches of his glory," Paul says there, "he may grant that you may be strengthened in your innermost being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love." And in the verses before this, just before today's text, Paul has revisited the prologue from Ephesians 1. And he says that he's thankful, essentially, that this family is big enough to include all who want to be a part of it. But the want to be a part of it includes loving and living as Christ did. Paul prays that they will be strengthened in their inmost being, that is, from the inside out. Or as Eugene Peterson put it in his message paraphrase, that Christ will live in you as you open the door and invite him in. Among the challenges the Ephesians had was that they were, as one writer described them, worldly, sophisticated, and you've heard it before, in no need of anyone other than themselves. There isn't a relationship that is important to us that we can live in by those terms. Important relationships need more of a commitment from us than that. When we take our families, our friendships, our faith community, our close relationships seriously enough, we are called to love as Christ did. And when we do, the things we care the most about are more able to be their healthiest. The standard is nearly impossible, right? Love as Christ did. But I think one of those God-sized dreams in life that we've been talking about lately, on a personal level, is believing that God is able to help us to be more than we can be on our own don't think you can live and love as Christ did, really? Husbands and wives, brothers and sisters, friends, employees, and employers, God believes you're capable of more than you think. And God waits for you to ask for the help, church, to be just that. We're going to join our voices and sing in response. If you've been with us for a while and have decided that you wanted to join your life to the church, Doc is not here, but I'm going to be waiting down front. Otherwise, any of us may have a response we want to make right where we are. We'll join our voices and stand as we sing hymn number 361, My Jesus, I Love Thee. Please remain standing. And you may have noticed in your worship bulletin or as you follow along that although our summer falls out of rhythm a little bit, and although many of us travel during the summer as we just did, the needs of the church continue on. If you have some catching up to do, you would do your church a wonderful service by taking care of that this week. We're thankful for the ways in which you are faithful. But we got a little catching up to do. Help us to come out of the summer right where we need to be. And we're thankful for anything that you are able to do and your faithfulness to that as always. Let's pray as we go from here to be God's people. Our God, you who are able to make us more than we think we can be, we pray that your transformation will continue this week. And as we live our lives, that every day we'll become more as you want us to be. Lead us, guide us, sustain us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us this hour at Second-Ponce de Leon Baptist Church. We count it an honor that you let us into your homes each week. Some of you are viewing us on the AIB network, others of you on YouTube. However you let us be a part of your life, we're grateful that you're inviting us into your home. I continue to be impressed with how many people find this a meaningful part of their week. I had a woman stop me not long ago, a woman I'd never met, and hugged me and said, you're my pastor. We count that a privilege, that we are that much a part of who you are. I hope if you're physically able, you'll join us at 2715 Peachtree Road and be a part of the worship service live. But we also appreciate that we're able to provide this service to folks who are not physically able to be here. However you're viewing us, we are honored by the fact that you do so and look forward to meeting you soon.